Ann Coggin during the week, and she was asking Sunday school classes to contribute to buying lunches for a parenting seminar to be held at our church in February. And with your permission, I think we ought to maybe give $100 or so to that effort. Tony, do we have it?
They have about $700 right now.
Okay. Is that okay with everybody, maybe contribute $100 to that? Is to underwrite the box lunches for a parenting seminar.
Are these people that can't buy lunch?
Ma'am?
Are these people that can't buy lunch?
I think they're trying to have lunch for everybody. And just provide it.
The church is paying.
The church is.
Oh.
Yes. Is that okay with everybody?
Yes.
I confessed to you last Sunday that I thought the lesson would be difficult because I didn't know a lot of the answers about heaven. And as we've done in this class, we got through it. We don't have all the answers. I certainly don't. But hopefully we spoke enough about heaven to recognize that that's the place that we all want to be one day when the Father takes us home. Today is even more difficult. I've confessed to you before my difficulty in understanding the doctrine of the Trinity. Now, I don't understand it completely, but I trust it even more. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Sometimes I find myself going to the Father when I should be speaking to the Holy Spirit. And sometimes I say in Jesus' name when I'm talking to the Father. I don't apologize to you about that. I apologize to the Trinity. But as I say, I trust it completely. Another concept that I have difficulty with is fully appreciating the holiness of God. In the Scripture, the Father says, "You shall not see my face. Anyone who sees my face will die." But yet we all have within our hearts a desire to be with the Father one day, to share in the glorious riches in Christ Jesus that are promised to those who trust Him. Listen to these words in Exodus, if you would, the 33rd chapter of Exodus, the 14th verse, a very personal encounter between our Father and Moses. Exodus 33:14, and he said, "My presence will go with you and I'll give you rest." And he said to him, "If your presence will not go with me, do not bring us up here. For how shall it be known that I have found favor in your sight, I and your people? Is it not in your going with us so that we are distinct, I and your people, from every other people on the face of the earth?" And the Lord said to Moses, "This very thing that you have spoken I will do, for you have found favor in my sight, and I know you by name." Moses said, "Please show me your glory." And he said, "I'll make all my goodness pass before you and will proclaim before you my name, the Lord. And I will be gracious to whom I will be gracious and will show mercy on whom I will show mercy." But he said, "You cannot see my face, for man shall not see me and live." And the Lord said, "Behold, there is a place by me where you shall stand on the rock. And while my glory passes by, I will put you in a cleft of the rock, and I will cover you with my hand until I pass by. Then I will take away my hand, and you shall see my back, but my face shall not be seen. Can you imagine that scene where God places Moses in the cleft of the rock and his entire glory passes by? In preparing the lesson, different verses came to my mind, and I'm reading through the Gospel of John, which happens to be my favorite book in all the Bible, because it's easy to understand, I thought, until I started reading the commentaries to the book of John. And it brings out even more. But I think it's in the Gospel of John where Jesus says, if you have seen me, you've seen the Father. Now, being from Aberdeen, Monroe County, Mississippi, I see a little conflict there. Because the scripture says, no man can look at the face of the Father. I think when I do a little study on that, when Jesus says, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father, I think it means if you have accepted me, you have accepted my Father. Aren't you glad that God chose you from the foundation of the earth, from the foundation of the world, to be one of his chosen children? When you accepted Christ as your Savior, you became justified. And from that moment on, we're being sanctified until the point that we take our last breath on this earth. And we're raised, our conscious soul is raised in the presence of Christ. There we're fully sanctified, made like him. We're a long way away, and he knew we would be. At the moment of our justification, he knew that we were sinners. But when we were justified by our faith and our trust in Jesus Christ, his Son, the Father would never look at our uncleanliness again. He would see only the holiness of Christ in whom we placed our trust. Now, doesn't that take off a lot of pressure from you? Doesn't that remove a lot of the difficulty of life? He knows we're going to step on our lip. He knows we're going to fail. But in Christ, I say it right, Barbara? I'm so glad you're here.
Welcome
back.
Thanks.
I still have a difficulty understanding the holiness of God. I can read the attributes of God. Omniscience. All knowing. Omnipotent. All powerful. Sometimes in reading the translations of the Hebrew where they referred to Jehovah, Jehovah Jireh, and the different things, the names for God, it helps us to understand. But I don't think we'll ever be able to fully comprehend the holiness of our Father. I guess in my simplistic mind, I choose to just let that go, and he'll reveal it to me at some point, maybe, and some point, maybe not. But I choose to hang on to the unfailing love that the Father has for his children. And I know that I'm one of his. And you know that you're one of his. And when everything is over, that's all that really matters. We go back to those words that say, nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. And then it recites, angels, nor heights, nor depth, nor principalities, nor things past, nor things to come. Nothing can separate us from the love that exists for us from our Father in our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. I often wonder why we sometimes just mess up that simple message by going into different doctrines and creating different churches and different religions. And why don't we go back to the statement in the high priestly prayer that Jesus, our Savior, prayed to his Father in that time of need for comfort and strength and reminder of why he came to earth. He says, may they all be one. How difficult is that? May we all be one in Christ. Imagine if God said something like this. I'll give you anything you desire, anything, perfect love, eternal peace. You'll never be afraid or alone. No confusion will enter your mind. No anxiety or boredom will enter your heart. You'll never lack for anything. There'll be no sin and no guilt, no rules, no expectations, no failure. You'll never be lonely. You'll never hurt. You'll never die. Only you'll never see my face. Can you imagine heaven without God? No. Me? Listen, with God and Moses had as much of God as any man in the Bible. God spoke to him in a book. God guided him with fire. God amazed Moses with the plagues. And when God grew angry with the Israelites and withdrew from them, he stayed close to Moses. He spoke to Moses as a man speaks with his friend. Moses knew God like no other man. But that wasn't enough. Moses yearned for more. Moses longed to see God. He even dared to ask, please show me your glory. Moses wanted to see God himself. And don't we? Isn't that why we long for heaven? We may speak about a place where there are no tears and no death, no fear, no night, but those are just the benefits of heaven. The beauty of heaven is seeing God. Heaven is God's heart. And our heart will only be at peace when we see. Because I have lived right, I will see your face, it says in Psalms. When I wake up, I will see your likeness and be satisfied. Satisfied. That's one thing we're not. We're not satisfied. Contentment is a difficult virtue because there's nothing on earth that can satisfy our deepest longing. We long to see our Father. The leaves of life are rustling with the rumor that we will, and we won't be satisfied until we do. We can't be satisfied, not because we're greedy, but because we're hungry for something not found on this earth. Only God can satisfy. Philip was right when he said, Lord, show us the Father, that's all we need. And I think that's when the Savior said, if you've seen me, Philip, you've seen the Father. Alas, therein lies the problem. God told Moses, but you cannot see my face because no one can see me and live. Wow. You know, I think it's the holiness of God that we couldn't stand to behold him. Because in looking at his holiness, our sinfulness is magnified. Justification. The day we were justified, the day we accepted Christ as our Savior, all our sins are removed. Those past and those to come. Because when we get home and the Father looks at us and judges us, he sees only his Son in whom we've placed our trust. Now Now, some folks can't accept that. As a matter of fact, they couldn't accept that when Jesus himself spoke it. How many miracles did some of those who walked with Jesus, how many miracles did they witness and still not believe? I would hope I wouldn't have been as hard-headed or as hard-hearted. Can you imagine standing there at the tomb in which Lazarus was dead and wrapped in those burial rags and hearing the words from our Savior that said, "Lazarus, come forth"? And as I've told you before, one pastor said that had our Savior not prefaced his remarks with the word Lazarus, all of the graves in the world would have burst open and those who would have saved would come forth. Do you believe that there will be a time when Jesus will return from the east to the Mount of Olives to call those who love him home? I do. That's what it said. You remember the disciple says, "Gentlemen, why do you stand here gazing into the sky? Do you not know that this Jesus who was raised will return again to the same place?" How many have been to the Mount of Olives? Wow. I can't imagine. Jerome, didn't they say that some of those olive trees were there the day that Jesus walked? They were there. I'd love to just touch one, just to be a little closer. I think Jesus said, "Blessed are those who have seen and believe. Blessed even more are those who have not seen yet believe." That's me and you. That's pretty plain. Aren't you glad you're blessed even more? Aren't you glad that you can trust the nail-pierced hand? At the moment of our death, when our conscious soul awakens in the presence of Christ, I wonder what he'll say. I wonder even more what I'll say. I hope it'll be filled with gratitude for what he did on the cross for me and for you, that allows us to pass from this temporary body, this temporary earth, where the scripture says a man's life is nothing but a vapor, poof, and it's gone, and we slip over into eternity. Doctor show that came on, it had the symbol for man and woman and then the little sideways eight, which
in case,
that's it, somebody near my I used to not like to focus on that little symbol, that sideways eight, infinity. I don't mind anymore because I know who's there. And he's prepared a place for me. Remember last Sunday I told you, Monty, a permanent, personal dwelling place for the Yogi. And he's been working on it a long time, so I know it's going to be nice. And his father will be there. And I won't have to see his face to believe in him, because I hope that I will have trusted him for every one of the moments that he has set for me to live. Our Father, who makes us the promise to be with us wherever we go, even until the end of the age, always keeps his promises for his children. He's never failed me yet. That's a good song. Holiness of God illuminates the sinfulness of man. Well, if it does, then what do we do? If it's true that anyone whose life is not holy will never see the Lord, where do we turn? There's a place near me where you may stand on a rock, he told Moses. When my glory passes that place, I'll put you in a large crack in the rock and cover you with my hand. Now, he told Moses about covering him with his hand. That's the same hand in which the scripture says he has your name written. You say, Yorkie must have a big hand. I told you before we started, I don't understand his holiness. I don't understand how big he is. But I choose to focus on the fact that he loves me. And he loves you. And I believe that with all my heart. If I didn't believe that, I wouldn't be standing up here telling you about it today. But I like the idea that he wrote my name on the palm of a hand, the same hand that covered Moses who trusted him while his glory passed by. Did you see what Moses was to do? What he was required to do? Neither did I. Did you notice who did the work? So did I. God did. God is active. God gave Moses a place to stand. God placed Moses in the crevice of the rock. God covered Moses with his hand. And God passed by. God revealed himself to Moses. Please remember that. God equipped Moses to catch a glimpse of God. All Moses did was ask. But oh, how he asked. Please show me your glory, he said. And that's all we can do. For only in asking do we receive, and only in seeking do we find. God is the one who will equip us for our eternal moment in the sun. Hasn't he given us the rock, his own son, Jesus the Christ? Hasn't he given us a cleft, his grace? And hasn't he covered us with his hand? It was pierced. And isn't the Father on his way to get us? But as splendid as are the gifts of heaven, it is not for those we wait. We wait to see our Father. And in the end, that'll be just enough. If you have seen me, you've seen the Father. He made that very simple statement. And what did the people who heard the statement do? They killed him for saying it. They crucified Jesus not for what he did, but what he said. He put himself in the same equality as God. And they killed him. But that was Friday. We, believers of the Son, know that the world was changed on Sunday. It was changed by an empty tomb. The empty tomb was spoken of by the Son. He said, on the third day, I'll rise. He also said, I'll come again and take you with me, that where I am, there you may be also. That's a promise. And he always keeps his promise. Aren't you glad? Aren't you glad that he chose you to trust in him? And you did. Nobody can ever take it away from you. Ever. It's done. You're justified. You're being sanctified. And when we all get home, maybe the Father will reveal some of himself to us at just the right time and in just the right way. And the mysteries of heaven will be made known. Oh, that's cause for joy. Maybe that's why the psalmist said, restore unto me the joy of my salvation. Maybe that ought to be what we ask for. Restore unto me the ultimate joy of my salvation. I've been saved from my sins and justified in Christ Jesus and sanctified until the day we get home. That's cause for great, great joy. Always remember who and whose you are. You're a child of God, and He loves you, even though we can't understand His holiness. Let's pray. Father, sometimes when we read the Holy Scriptures, it's easy to understand. Other times we get to concepts and ideas, revelations that we just can't understand at all. Forgive me that I can't understand your holiness. But Father, I do respect it and love it, just as I love you. Keep us in communion with you, Father. We can't all be Moses who hears the exact words from your Spirit, who sees a burning bush that is not consumed. But Father, on the day that we accepted your Son as our Lord and Savior, that's enough. Thank you, Father, for sending him to die on the cross, a cruel death to remove our sins from us and prepare a place for us with you and your glory in that place that we call heaven. Bless our time together as we go to worship. Accept our songs of praise and thanksgiving and our gratitude to you, Father, for sending your Son